Game 3 of the Ontario Lacrosse Association Junior C Final. The Meredith Cup could be hoisted tonight. Peterborough with a 2-0 lead in this best-of-5 series over the Six Nations Warriors and a chance to claim the title on home floor. David Foote and Stephen Stamp here with you on this simulcast presentation with Extra 90.5 FM and JVI Sports. Glad to have you along as we get set for, again, what could be an historic game for lacrosse fans here in the Liftlock City.
Yeah, I was talking to both coaches before the game. Six Nations, Terry Hill just said he felt like they were a little in awe of this building and this atmosphere when they came in for game one. He wants them to be a little more playing their game this time. And Dave Baker said the same thing, just play their game.
And this building caused a lot of discussion around town this week, and we'll get into the whole movement of this game into this building in just a little bit. The Warriors have the first possession. They'll start the game moving from right to left in their road blacks with orange shoulders, black stripes on the sides as well. They're on the bench across from our broadcast position, and they'll lose that possession quickly. Only about 15 seconds into the game or so, Lakers take it over.
Adam, quick break. Sorry, go ahead.
Adam Churchill dishes it off, gets it back and shoots, and it's in. They score. Just like that, first shot of the game finds the back of the net, and the Lakers are on the board quickly.
Nice break by the Lakers, pushing the pace. They had some success doing that in the earlier games, and that's going to make a big difference for them. I think their strength and maturity, as Coach Dave Baker likes to call it, is a big factor, and taking advantage of an early break has got to be helpful for them, because they already, being up 2-0, winning 9-3 in game two, they've got certainly the aura of invincibility going for them.
Adam Churchill, the goal scorer, his 17th of this postseason, now 17 goals, 28 assists in just 13 postseason games. Warriors with the ball now, carried over the Peterborough line by Montour. Dished off to the far side, no shot for the Warriors, working on the far side of the floor. Here comes one from the far side, off a body, and that'll deflect away. Shot clock expires as well. Lakers will get back the ball.
The Six Nations Warriors, didn't face a lot of challenges this summer. They had a few games against Wilmot that were close. They won every one, though, but they didn't face the kind of competition that Peterborough did with Cornwall and Clarington pushing them, and you can see that it's really hurt them.
Quick shot missing just wide. Yeah, a much tougher road to the final for the Peterborough Lakers, but it's strange. You look at the Warriors' record in the regular season to even see them in the final. A 3-13 team is here in the Meredith Cup final and fighting to stay alive here as the Lakers almost get a chance with Travis Ferguson trying to drive out of the near corner.
Yes, but the 3-13 record, a little deceiving, since they actually went 16-0 and forfeited 13 games for paperwork infringement or infraction where they're using some midget call-ups. So they didn't lose a game all year, so it's really not that surprising. It's a little bit of a tough break for Halton Hills and Wilmot, who had to play them early in the playoffs.
Quick shot and a good save there from Drew Hutchinson in goal again for the Lakers tonight. Hutchinson doing all right offensively in this postseason as well, with 4 assists to his credit. Lakers give the ball right back though. Warriors will start to play from their bench, brought to the near side for Keaton Smoke. Quick pass across and that'll miss the intended target, bouncing around on the far side. Warriors have it again. Back up top to Mount Pleasant. Shot will miss wide. Scooped up by Wesley Whitlow on the far side of the floor. Tossed off to a teammate, put in tight. Spinning shot from Lyle Hill, kept out again by Hutchinson.
And Hutchinson seeing the ball very well, and Wesley Whitlow has been a leading scorer. I'll let you take this.
Churchill almost got away from the defender as he came streaking off the bench. He'll fire one back to Adam Kitchen. Transition player, played a little bit with the Junior A Lakers at the start of the season. Back to Churchill, trying to wind his way in. Now Kitchen fakes the pass. Came out of his stick, picked up by Churchill, dropped down low, chance at the side of the net, and that'll be kept out by the nation's netminder, and the Warriors quickly will hustle it down the floor. Tyler Fox McKenzie, the defender, using the wheels, and then passing it off. Backhand shot from Spencer Martin as he came off the bench, missing. Rebound is collected by Mount Pleasant. Thrown back to the shooter spot. Low shot kicked away by Hutchinson. And the Lakers able to get back possession as a bouncing ball in front of the Peterborough bench. Knocked back into the stick of Mitch Ogilvy.
Six Nations not getting a lot of great scoring chances. Wesley Whitlow did lead the league in scoring in the playoffs coming into this series, and he's really been shut down by the Lakers. They would love to get him going.
See a wooden stick on the floor as the Lakers get a shot. Good save. And the Warriors a chance to break it out on a long feed. That will connect. Warriors forward, backing up as the Laker defense gets there, waits for help, dumps it in front, and a shot will miss high over the net of Hutchinson. Lakers back with the ball and rushing away, but we'll get a whistle here and they'll turn the ball over. 15-18 still to go, just about 5 minutes into this first period of game three of the Emeritus Cup final. Shot from the near side, kept out by Hutchinson, and the rebound chased down by the Warriors' Keaton Smoke in the near corner. Trying to spin off a check and then dish it to Hill. Cuts to the middle and fires. He rung it off the left post. And the rebound will come all the way back down into the Warrior zone.
Lyle Hill half an inch away from banking that one in off the post. And they want to get some, they don't want to fall behind too much. This team did a great job coming back in game one to within a goal. And then a brilliant goal by the Lakers, John Lynch, really made the difference. And they just never got back into this series.
Long bouncing shot from Smoke careens into the far side corner. Madison General chasing it down for the Warriors, but it's the Lakers who get it. Here's a long out lead pass for John Lynch. He shoots, and I guess it stayed out. The nation's goaltender lost it as well, and a tough break for the Lakers as they had a good chance about 6 minutes into this first period.
A little lucky for Busby Korver as it did get through him.
And back the other way, the Warriors will score. Lakers a little bit slow getting back, and a bounce shot between the legs of Hutchinson is going to even the score at one.
Emmett Smith with a nice shot, just fires it in there, and that's a huge goal for them. As I was saying, you know, they got back within a goal in game one after being down, and then the Lakers got that goal. And you got to give some credit to the defender, Nick Saltern, who threw the pass back between his legs like a center snapping the ball to the quarterback. Great play, and Lynch buried it. And they got their feet back under them and ran away. But you know the Warriors are going to want to just stay with them. They're not used to trailing. They really haven't trailed any games this year.
Warriors get the ball off the faceoff. They get it in deep and a quick shot bouncing over the net. Now they're at it again. Bradley Hill winds up and fires it wide. And the Lakers able to get that ball behind the net. And they'll break it out from there. And they drop the ball off to Adam Churchill. Back for Kitchen. Thought about the long winding shot, changed his mind. Now some nice passing by the Lakers and a shot just over the net. In tight. Kitchen hustles over to the far side, rubs out Dalton Vanevri. And forces him into the far side corner of the nation's zone. But the Warriors will get the ball anyways. The Laker shot clock expires.
You can see the effort, though, by the Lakers going after that loose ball. That's one thing Dave Baker said he actually wasn't very happy with in game two, which they won 9-3, was that he felt like they were losing a lot of loose ball battles, just not going after them as hard as they needed to. And you can see he's talked to them because they're going after every loosey.
Yeah, and a good crowd here as well tonight at the PMC. Of course, this game got moved from the Kinsman Arena due to a pretty strong campaign by the lacrosse fans here in the city. They knew that the Kinsman likely wouldn't be big enough. And with a game this big, as we mentioned, it could be Peterborough's first ever Meredith Cup championship, and they wanted to have some fans in the building to see it.
I asked Dave Baker what happens if they do win tonight, if there's an on-floor presentation. He said, I don't know, I've never been here before.
Yeah, it's definitely new scenes for the Lakers and their fans as the Warriors bring it to center floor. 12 and a half to go in this first period of game three. First penalty of the game's coming. Smoke took a stick up in the cage, passes it off, and a shot is kept and held by Hutchinson. And it looks like the Lakers will go to the PK for the first time tonight.
John Lynch, the MVP of the first game, he had a terrific two-way performance, killing penalties, scoring a couple of goals, playing great defense in transition. And he got the stick up a little. I think Smoke sold it a bit, kind of flicked the head back, a la Sean Evans. But, but you know, once you get your stick up around the chin, you're going to you're going to take a penalty more often than not.
Warriors had the second best power play in the regular season, about 21.8%. Peterborough's penalty kill was second as well, 97.2, so a pretty good special teams battle shaping up as a long shot will bounce away. That was Madison General who let fly for the Warriors and forced to chase this ball all the way back into his own end with only five on the shot clock. So he'll lob it toward the Laker net, and you'll hear the buzzer to signal the shot clock violation.
That was a pretty nice play because they actually ran that intentionally off the backboards. You can see one of the players, I think it was Bradley Hill, motioning to actually bounce that off the boards and have somebody cut to it.
Churchill takes it himself, makes two Warriors collide in their own end. Churchill now trying to find a way out front of the goal, and he'll elect to kill some time. Good veteran move to run it up to the top of the zone. Of course, no shot clock running with the Lakers killing a penalty here. About a minute five left to go in that high sticking penalty. Lakers with it far side of the zone up top. Two Warriors watch the ball carrier. Trying to make out the number, and that ball comes loose. And a big hit. Able to keep that ball loose.
Colton Armstrong coming in to lay a big hit exactly so that the Warriors couldn't break away with it. They still get possession, but Peterborough had a chance to get their defense out, which is a big step for them.
9 minutes in, 1-1 the score. Peterborough's goal from Churchill early on. It's a long shot kept out by Hutchinson. Here is the Peterborough goal scorer, Churchill. Made a fake to cut to the middle and again decides to hold on, glances at the clock, and takes a little jog into the near side corner. Churchill, switch of direction. Back up top toward the top of the zone and then back and forth, lost the handle. He took a shove for Riley Jameson, and now it's carried back down to the other end of the floor by Colin Montour. Montour tried to drive the net, knocked away from him by Travis Ferguson. And now a race back the other way for the Lakers. Colton Armstrong tried to dish that off to Riley Caldwell, joining the play late. And now Caldwell fighting to pick up the ball on the far side and does. We're back to 5-on-5, and a pass in front didn't work. And then a shot wide didn't work. As the Lakers pick it up again with 15 left on the shot clock, turned over and almost a breakaway the length of the floor. A shot and a good save by Hutchinson as the Laker defense quickly called into action on the transition play.
Almost a breakaway, and Riley Caldwell almost broken that hit by the player coming off the bench. Caldwell with the ball a few steps away from it, didn't see it coming at all. And he kind of buckled in half as he took that hit from the side and back.
Arrows possession as it's carried up the floor by Owen Martin. He'll hand it off and head to the bench. The offensive unit for the Warriors steps onto the floor with 9.5 to go in the first period of game three. Pass down low to the near side of the goal. Back out and a hard shot. That's the second post that the Warriors have hit in this first period. And a ball will bounce into the Laker bench.
Warriors did look a little intimidated on Saturday here. They don't tonight. They look like they're ready to play and much more confident, which should make for a tight, very interesting game.
On it also would help, I guess, from the Six Nations standpoint to know that you're a game away from losing the series as Peterborough come back. Slowing it down, though, is John Lynch. Now, with all the talk of moving this game to this building, as Churchill tries to run in, spins, shoots, and a save. You're wondering if it's maybe a little bit of bulletin board material for the Six Nations Warriors to go, oh, you want to, you know, move it into the bigger building and get on the nice turf to raise the trophy? Likely will put them into another gear on the other side of the floor. Long pass down floor. Travis Ferguson picking it up for the Lakers. Dished it off. A shot and a good save by Dylan Busby-Corver with a left glove. And now the Lakers trying to get it back at center floor, but they can't do it. Montour played it into the middle. And now the Warriors want to slow it down. 15 seconds left on the shot clock. They'll work a play from the far side. And a shot will deflect into the near corner. Wesley Whitlow over there after it and played it in behind the Laker net, came out in front, Whitlow with a shot, and another good save by Hutchinson. He's been on point through the first 12 minutes, 7 seconds of the game.
And the Warriors get the ball back after a loose ball foul, and then some pushing and shoving. Looks like both players are going to go. It's Colin Montour and Colton Armstrong, who are a pair of very fast, very active players, one for each team, Armstrong for the Lakers and Montour for the Warriors. You're going to get two for, I think it was slashing indicated by Matt Garrison.
That's what it looked like. So a little bit of four on four here for a couple minutes as we move through the mid stages of this tied first period, 1-1 the score. David Foote, Steven Stamp here with you on Peterborough's Talk Sports Radio, Extra 90.5, and the JVI Video Network as well. Lakers are going to force the turnover back in their own zone. And now taken down hard to the floor is a Laker defender. And we've got a penalty coming up for holding to the Warriors. So Peterborough will go to a 4-on-3 power play.
That's just a great effort there by the Peterborough player. I think it was Nick Saltern actually trying to hold on to that ball. Or was it, no, it was Jake Venton, the captain, who does a great job for this team. And Wesley Whitlow trying to cause the loose ball. Venton going to try and grab it, trying to get a hold of it. And Salter and Whitlow just held on to him a little too long and took him to the ground with his loose arm.
So about a minute 20 until the offsetting penalties expire. Quick stick try on the far side, kept out by Busby. Korver going post to post.
That's great lateral movement, but the Lakers get it back.
Took the net with him, did the Six Nations goaltender. Churchill tries to play it off for Riley Caldwell. They take up the top position, and then Caldwell knocked down, and the Warriors a chance to break back the other way. It's a 2-on-0. Chance right in front of the net, and Hutchinson makes a good save. Lakers will get back the ball.
Nice hustle there by Darian Jacobs, the big righty forward, to race all the way down the length of the floor after Chauncey Hill and just get a bit of him as he's trying to get the shot off.
15 seconds left on the Peterborough shot clock. Churchill can't drive his way in. Dishes it off, long shot, stopped. And the rebound collected by Dalton Van Every. And the Lakers are gonna get back the ball though.
Too many men. Six Nations forward jumping off the bench just a second early. Emmett Smith, a better step, and the referee was looking straight at the bench as their defender sprinted towards one door while Smith came out the other.
18 seconds or so left in the offsetting penalties. Lakers with the ball in the offensive zone, a chance in tight, and that's going to miss. Another Laker player is barreled without the ball, and Peterborough will keep possession here. Here is a shot, score, Adam Kitchen.
Beautiful play by Kitchen, and he really made that play at the beginning as he picked up the ball on the restart and immediately hustled it in to get some pressure on, never let the Warriors get set on defense, passed it across, took the pass back and ripped it, and you could tell Warriors were never, like I said, set, either the defense or the goalies, because he just pushed the pace so quickly.
Just able to lean back, reach out, and rip that one underhand and find the back of the net to give the Lakers a 2-1 lead as we move into the latter stages of this first period. Again, a victory tonight, and Peterborough will hoist its first ever Meredith Cup. Good crowd in the building with lots of orange t-shirts as well. The Six Nations fans travel very well regardless of what level of lacrosse they're going to watch. And the Warriors have it with Fox McKenzie. Drops it off to a teammate off the bench. Now the Warrior offense getting set. Pass here on the left side. Nice spin move by Mount Pleasant. And he couldn't get a good shot off. Rebound into a Warrior stick. Long shot again from Mount Pleasant, missing wide. And a quick one from the far side, also kept out by Hutchinson.
Hutchinson saw that shot from Emmett Smith the whole way, but the one earlier came through some traffic and was a little bit trickier. I think he had an open spot, but just missed the low to high.
All kinds of trouble for Peterborough's Darian Jacobs, able to drop it off though. Lakers working around the outside. Churchill wants to find a way into the middle of the floor and is stripped of the ball by Bailey Sky, and he'll race back on a breakaway. Sky scores. Just found a way to wedge it past Hutchinson on a breakaway, and it is 2-2.
Beautiful high hard fake by Sky. Gets Hutchison raising the arm to try and make the save, and a quick drop of the stick by Sky tucks it between the arm and the hip of Hutchison. That's a gorgeous goal to make it 2-2. The goalie's going to get a drink of water with 4:33 to go in the first period here on Extra 90.5 FM and GBI Sports Network. And David, a good thing that the community was able to get this game moved here, because you can see there are a lot of people here, a lot of Warriors fans, but a ton of Lakers fans who are here enjoying this Junior C action, again, for the first time for the Lakers in the final.
Yeah, and the support for the junior teams in this city has been outstanding over the last couple weeks. You look at the success of the Merritt Precision Junior A Lakers in the OLA Junior A final, and this building was jammed for that a couple nights ago as well, so it's made for some exciting times for the many lacrosse fans here in Peterborough. Warriors have it in the Lakers zone. There's a great chance and they score. Spencer Martin, with just his fifth of the playoff, somehow weaseled his way into the middle, and a quick shot got by Hutchison, and Six Nations have their first lead of the night.
And Martin is exception to the rule for the forwards here pretty much on the Warriors, because he's a big strong guy. They have a lot of young, small, talented forwards, but he is a big guy and used that size and strength to just bull his way through a couple of checks and fight his way right on top of the crease and bury it.
See how the Lakers respond to being down for the first time in this game. 3:57 now on the clock, and another chance for Wesley Whitlow. He'll spin off the defender and tries to dump it past Hutchison, and the Peterborough goaltender with a nice job to make the stop. Churchill jogging in, plays it down into this near corner. Back up to Churchill along the right boards and across. Good perimeter ball movement from the Lakers. Churchill in the middle, shakes off a defender, carries it low, back out top. Here's a long shot off the post and out of play, and they're gonna give the Lakers the ball.
Caldwell had the spot, shot through a lot of traffic, sub shot, just barely, the stick almost grazing the carpet, and the goalie absolutely did not see it, but he rang it off the post.
Another one in tight, bounce shot is stopped by Busby Korver. It's a nice ball movement by the Lakers, but not able to find the back of the net on that trip down the floor. Warriors again set it up. Pass to the near side is Mount Pleasant. Played it back into the middle. Flicked away by a Laker defender. Eventually picked up and tossed up ahead. Here's Dalton Hill. All alone, Hill will score! That is a beauty by Dalton Hill. And the Lakers tie it up at 3.
Almost went into slow motion with kind of the high step and a couple of jukes and jives. It really sold the shot over to his left and pulled it back. Busby Korver heading for it completely and totally bought the fake and not a hard shot at all, just dropped it into the empty spot.
Have to give some credit to the Laker who made the outlet pass, kind of a little backhand flip that sailed a third of the floor, and then Lakers' Dalton Hill able to do the rest of the work and tie it up again.
Interesting note, the Warriors have led each of these games, 2-1 leads in games 1 and 2. So early is not when they have trouble, it's as they get going into the game. So this is a crucial time for Six Nations.
2:20 to go in this first period of game 3. Lakers and Six Nations Warriors tied. There's a quick shot by Peterborough, kept out by Busby Korver, and the Lakers are gonna get back the ball as Six Nations goaltender couldn't hold on to it. So they'll set it up again. They like to work from this top right side. Penalty coming up here to the Warriors, so the Peterborough netminder Hutchison heads to the bench in favor of the extra attacker. Ferguson to Churchill to Kitchen, winding and firing, and the save will be made.
Adam Kitchen, it's going to be an illegal cross-check call, and Adam Kitchen kind of shakes his head because you get the six attackers out there, you got lots of time, you move the ball around, try and create something, and he lets the sidearm shot rip and hits Busby Korver right in the middle of the belly pad. You're always disappointed in yourself when you take a shot like that.
Lakers to their second power play of the night, 0-1. They'll be on the man advantage for the remainder of this period and a little bit of the start of the next, barring a goal, of course. About a minute and a half left in the period. About a minute 40 or so left in the Laker power play. They'll have to get the ball back first, though. Warriors have it in the offensive zone. Again, no shot clock for Six Nations as they whip the ball around at the top. Carried to the near side, and the Six Nations player has gone down rather slowly. And I don't know if he got caught by a stick or twisted a knee, but down on the floor.
Yeah, he was taking some chops from Tom Weber, some pretty heavy slashes. We'll see if he's got if he's going to draw a penalty. Matt Garrison actually came over to talk to the Lakers bench. I don't see the penalty box open, but Emmett Smith just slowly, as you said, kind of collapsed to the floor. Yeah. You could see he was in pain. Definitely looks like an upper body issue. And yeah, I'm sure it's from the slashes.
Likely was. Hasn't gotten up yet, just chatting with the Six Nations trainer. Again, Peterborough is on the power play, tied 3-3 here in game number one. And now Smith back to his feet and seems to be all right. Lucky for him, he can go get a better look at it here in just a minute, 2 seconds. So after the killed play, we'll have a draw at center ice, center floor, same thing. The dots
in the same
spot. It
will be center ice in the next few days because the ice is going in this weekend.
Yeah, I'm just getting ahead of myself. Peterborough Pete's training camp opening in just a few weeks here at the Peterborough Memorial Center. Lakers almost turn it over a little bit lazily offensively here. Churchill taken down, bailed out by Darian Jacobs, who picks up the loose ball. Errant pass off the near glass, collected by Travis Ferguson. Ferguson with 5 on the clock, rifles it wide of the net, and he'll chase the ball back to the center of the floor, but shot clock expires with 25 left in the first period.
So the Warriors have a chance to kill the rest of the period on the short man, but try and get a shot at the end. A little surprised they don't actually pull the goalie to get 5-on-5. But we're going to have a pair of slashing calls off ball, just away from the play. Some players battling for position. Tyler Brown and Nick Saltern. They'll each go for 2, and we're going to have 4-on-3 for Peterborough. They're still not pulling the goalie. Busby Corver actually just leaning casually against the crossbar. I'd be pulling the goalie and get it 4-on-4, and I wouldn't have taken a shot there.
Yeah, long shot leaves Peterborough with now 12 seconds to get back up the floor and get a shot. Here's a pass to the far side, but it's going to miss. 8 seconds left on the clock, and it doesn't look like Peterborough's going to get the shot. They're forced to chase the ball back into the neutral area. They'll get possession with 2 seconds left. Here's a quick one wide, and that'll miss. And that'll do it for period number one. So a back and forth first period, some pretty good lacrosse. Back to the Peterborough Memorial Center. It is game 3 of the Ontario Junior C Lacrosse Final. The Meredith Cup could be decided tonight. David Foote and Stephen Stamp here on Peterborough's Talk Sports Radio, Extra 90.5, and the JVI Video Network. But you're liking what you hear, you want to see how the action played out, you can check it out where?
JVISportsNetwork.com, and it will be loaded up. You'll be able to check out the action, and all 3 games of the series will be there, so you can watch the development of the series throughout.
This is, again, the potential deciding game. Peterborough wins, that'll be it. They lead this best of 5 series 2-0. Already. Teams switch sides, so Peterborough moving right to left across the floor in their home whites with the lift lock on the jersey, the blue, green, and white shorts. The Six Nations Warriors in their Halloween colors, black and orange, on the other side of the floor. Lakers look to go to work. A bounce pass knocked away by Owen Martin, and now a long lead feed is going to connect with Colin Montour. His shot is stopped nicely by Drew Hutchinson.
Hutchinson just throwing that left foot out as Montour had a pretty nice shot. He's a hard-working and speedy kid, and broke away nicely, but just stymied by Hutchinson.
Lakers started the period on the power play. That time has expired. We're playing 4-on-4 here until some offsetting penalties run out in just under a minute. Six Nations with the ball. They'll have to work all the way from their own end. Emmett Smith takes it off the bench. One hands it around a defender and then hustles his way deep into the Peterborough zone. Cuts to the net and tried to catch Hutchinson going the wrong way and missed the net. Peterborough get the rebound. Back down the floor, chance in tight for Darian Jacobs missing. Again, back and forth quickly as Owen Martin will slow it down for Six Nations. Wants to get the offensive unit on the floor. Madison General to Bailey Sky. Had a nice one on a breakaway not long ago. Sky back up to the middle and a shot off the shoulder of Hutchinson. Lakers have the rebound. Penalties expire. And we're back to 5-on-5. Just about 2 minutes into period number two.
But another penalty coming immediately.
Shot from the Lakers stopped by Busby Korver. And the Six Nations penalty bench will open again. A high sticking call. We'll see Peterborough head to their third power play of the game. 0-for-2 on the night.
And two of Six Nations penalties now on Wesley Whitlow, the high scoring forward who's taken a pair of penalties a couple hundred feet away from his net, one holding earlier and this one high sticking. So you can tell he's getting frustrated, but his coaches are not going to be happy with that discipline.
Laker power play was not great during the regular season, but it is now as they shoot and score.
Colton Armstrong with the outside rip about two steps outside the dotted line at the top of the formation, and really not a whole lot to it. Nobody near him, no screen. He just fired it. Busby Korver was coming across the net, and Armstrong did fire against the grain. It looked like Busby Korver just overstepped the shot, and it bounced just past his stick and off the inside of his foot.
So it is 4-3 Peterborough, and a battle for the ball off the draw. Kicked all the way into the Peterborough end and finally scooped up by the Warriors. Here's a chance at the side of the net. Pass to the near side over the stick of Owen Martin. And Martin in a battle for the ball here along the near side wall. Thrown into the middle by Whitlow. Quick shot from Brown, turned away. Nations keep the ball. Try to work it up top, they do. Tyler Brown looking for a lane to shoot, lost the handle, and the Lakers couldn't pick it up going the other way. It won't matter as Six Nations are going to be awarded possession.
Dalton Hill absolutely flattened one of the Warriors forwards as the Brown was losing that. Now we're going to have a penalty. Matt Garrison keeping his eyes on what was going on after the earlier incident. So Lyle Hill for Six Nations, and Riley Morgan will head off for Peterborough.
And it's a 5-minute penalty given the Peterborough way for roughing. So a 3-minute power play for the Six Nations Warriors, and I didn't see much that I thought warranted 5 minutes, but either way, Lakers will be down by a man for a few minutes here.
In 2 minutes, of course, they're 4-on-4 right now for the first 2 minutes while they're both out.
Errant pass out of the stick of Tyler Brown, hits the boards, bounces back into the Six Nations end. Just 9 seconds left on this shot clock. Six Nations get the penalty for holding. The Lakers get it for roughing. And Peterborough with possession off a nice save again by Hutchinson. Kitchen turns on the Jets on the far side. Plays it to Churchill. Tried to pass it in the middle and it'll bounce out of the corner to Busby Korver in the Six Nations net. He'll scoop it up and survey the scene downfield. Long pass is going to bounce right to his counterpart Hutchinson. And Hutchinson takes the shorter feed here on the near side and hits Jake Fenton.
Isaiah Mount Pleasant looked a little surprised by that pass. He was all the way up the floor, and the long pass from the goalie Busby Korver was actually a perfect one-hop bouncer, but he just wasn't looking.
Churchill again, carrying it toward the net. Stop, a little shake, trying to get around the defender and lost the ball. Comes loose to the near side boards and picked up there by Six Nations. Shot clock going off was the remnants of the Laker possession. Playing 4-on-4 here. for just a little longer. Quick stick try. Nice save by Hutchinson, sliding across to that right post to make the save. Another low shot, and Hutchinson sees it all the way. That time the Warriors pushing into the crease and yanking out the ball, so Peterborough will get possession here 5 minutes into the second period.
Bit of an interesting call because Drew Hutchinson had the ball. It looked like in his stick, Tyler Brown or Wesley Whitlow reached in to get it. So if you're going to call possession, should it not be a two-minute checking in the crease call?
Right.
Lakers are shorthanded now. 2:45 left in that five-minute major.
So Kitchen will take some time to jog up top. You hear the Laker fans start their traditional penalty kill clap. Kitchen getting the business on the far side. Make that arm strong.
Runs by the net, doesn't even take a look at the goalie. Smart play, just going to kill as much time as possible with still 2.5 minutes to go in the penalty.
Lakers coaching staff is directing this penalty kill from the bench like a choir. Armstrong still holding on to this ball. Almost killed 45 seconds on his own and now loses possession. Oh, that is a vicious cross check by the Peterborough player, Darian Jacobs.
He was getting very frustrated with Tyler Fox McKenzie, who was all over him. And he'll take two for high sticking, so it's going to be a 5-on-3.
I didn't see again necessarily what deserved 5 minutes on the first Peterborough penalty, but if that one is only two,
the other one must have been nasty.
He got off easy there. So either way, yeah, two-man advantage for the Warriors. Call it for 2 minutes. There's 2 minutes left in the five-minute major. 2 minutes now in this high-sticking penalty. So lots of room to work for the Warriors as they look to tie the game. Peterborough lead at 4-3 with the only goal in the period. Pass in front. Nice right shoulder save by Hutchinson. And a Warrior stepped in the crease. Lakers will get the ball. Minute 40 to go as it's run up the floor. Churchill lobs it over to the far side. And a little bit of breathing room until two black jerseys come over to confront the Laker ball carrier.
And John Lynch is great at this. He is so good. Almost Zach Currier-esque, the way he can move, hold on to the ball, elude checkers.
Huge hit. And there's going to be a penalty coming, but talk about toughness. Wow. Lynch took that hard hit into the boards and just kept ticking until he went to the ground, and they eventually blow the play dead.
Gavin Skye is going to get, I assume, 4 minutes for checking from behind. We'll see what... it's just two for charging. For Gavin Skye, he took a big run at Lynch, ran him into the boards from behind, and then when he saw the penalty was coming, pushed him, 40 feet along the boards, trying to get him out over the restraining line to get play stopped.
So the Lakers' fourth power play, when it comes, will be a short one. They still have to kill off about 1:09 of two-man advantage time, and then they'll get two guys back and go up a man. 13 minutes left in this second period. Lakers still lead it 4-3. If you're just joining us, it is game three of the Ontario Junior C Championship, the Meredith Cup. Peterborough leading the best of five series 2-0.
What an effort by Adam Churchill. He's knocked down. The ball pops out. He's scurrying around on his hands and knees there to keep the ball protected from the Warriors players. And they're cross-checking him in the back. He kept working until he drew the call.
Nice split of the D by Churchill as he turns back at the top of the zone. Takes another hard shove. Down he goes. Gets wrestled to the ground. Takes a couple extra shots while he's down there. And the Lakers will keep the ball.
And Colin Montour throws his hands up in the air wondering about the call, but I thought there was no question. I thought it should have been earlier. As there's nothing wrong with the way they took him down, but the way they kept checking him when he was down without the ball was definitely a foul.
Lakers give the ball back to John Lynch. Looks to be okay after taking that hard hit, being watched very closely by Montour and Owen Martin. 7 seconds left in the first Laker penalty, 8 left in the other. But the Warriors will get the ball, and now as they begin to kill a penalty, have possession in the offensive zone. But they fall to 0-for-3 on the man advantage as they weren't able to score. on that lengthy power play.
And that's a huge save by Drew Hutchison as Wesley Whitlow is left all alone. Whitlow smashes his stick against the boards as he goes to the bench. He is clearly growing frustrated. Can't score in much in this series. He's taken a couple of penalties way at the far end of the floor from his own net today. And when they were up 5-on-3, he was the safety valve. He wasn't even involved in that power play.
And you can tell why he's frustrated. A guy who coming into tonight had 24 goals in 11 playoff games and hasn't barely had a sniff tonight. So a shot clock violation gives the ball back to the Warriors with just enough time to kill off this power play. Lakers will pick it up just briefly. Falls into the stick of Gavin Skye. He'll rifle it high off the far corner, and Peterborough have possession. No outlet feed yet, as it's carried up the floor by Brown, and he'll leave it off there for Churchill. Churchill trying to run to the far side. Has some help on the near side. Good pass, shot, score!
Wow. Riley Caldwell with a beauty. Gets the pass, coming across just above the goal line, extended. Actually slides down towards the goal line. Looks like he's going to shoot near side, try and tuck it between Busby Korver and the post, but manages to just fire the shot across in front of Busby Korver. There was a very slim angle, and he bounced it in off the post. That's a gorgeous goal to make it 5-3.
Yeah,
a
nice show of skill for the Lakers to get this two-goal lead. And now they got to start to put the pressure on a little bit more, try and open up a little bit of space. Nobody's really been able to go on a run in this game as we get a ball up off the ceiling and into the seats. Riley Caldwell, the goal for Peterborough, his 13th of this Meredith Cup campaign. Little bit of jump in the step of the Lakers now as hustling to the net was Caldwell again. Sends it to the back door. No, they didn't. Hit the outside of the net. Now they'll try again. And a good save. And now some contact with the goaltender, and everybody's going to get in here. There was an initial penalty on the play.
The first penalty is to Vern Hill, number 14 for Six Nations, as he cross-checked Darian Jacobs as he went into the crease. Jacobs, with that cross-check to the back, actually went into Busby Korver, who was falling down, and cross-checked him while he was down because he took the check to the back. And then, of course, all heck starts to break loose. They go after Jacobs. Somebody came in, I'm not sure. I think it was actually Gavin Skye again, or is he still in the box? Did he just head over?
Yeah, they just sent him over, and
okay,
now
so
Skye offsetting penalties.
Darian Jacobs has been ripped his helmet off and was ready to go.
So the Lakers should get lucky if it turns out they still have a power play. They would have had one without any of that extra stuff.
Yeah, the first call clearly was that cross-check to the back of Jacobs. Now, I don't know if Jacobs is going to get two, because there's no question he was cross-checking the goalie while he was laying down in the crease, which is what brought Skye in. Now, Gavin Skye is being sent across the floor. He's heading to the bench. I thought maybe they were sending him to the dressing room, but he's just going over to the bench.
So now only offsetting penalties. It looks like there are 5 minutes each.
Yeah, and they're going to be taken off. You can see Mac Harrison signaling to the scorekeepers to take them off because they are matching five-minute majors. So we stay 5-on-5. Not like with the minors, they would have moved down.
So 5-on-5 we play. Offsetting 5 minute major penalties, and the Lakers took themselves out of a power play situation. In this situation, they could have just let it go, but that extra stuff leads to offsetting 5 minute major penalties. Hard shot from the Warriors will miss. It'll bounce all the way back to the top of the zone. Kept in though by Madison General, and General getting worked over here on the near side by Venton. Passed it off to the far side, a quick shot missing. Lakers get it back here, and now they'll carry it up the floor. Great support here at the PMC for the Junior C Lakers tonight. Ball on the far side of the floor, into the middle, bounce shot off the crossbar. Lakers almost had a three-goal lead. Warriors trying to regroup here and get the offensive unit on the floor, hustled forward by Riley Jamison. Left it at the top of the zone, and now a try at the side of the net, barreling into the crease. Hutchinson made a great save and has to stop another as well.
Both of them on Cecil Montour, who drove hard to the net, was falling, got the shot off, very close going in the net, but did get the shot. And as he got up off the floor, the ball just bounced to him to give him an easy chance on the second one.
9 minutes left in the second period, 5-3 Peterborough. Here's a chance, and that one is stopped, but pushed into the crease is Kitchen, and the Lakers will keep the ball here. Fresh 30 as well after the shot. So they reset it out of the far corner, carried up top, pass swung here to the near side. Riley Caldwell, most recent Peterborough goal scorer, dumping it off, and a no shot yet as three Warriors converge on Armstrong and eventually come up with a ball. Could have been a kick called on the Warriors back at the other end of the floor. Their transition's gonna break down. Tyler Brown eventually scoops up the ball and now has to wait, but 15 seconds have ticked off the shot clock already. Dump pass intended for Madison General will miss. Laker D able to pin General along the near side boards. Only 2 seconds left on the shot clock, and a good defensive possession for Peterborough. They'll get back the ball now.
That was a great idea by Emmett Smith. Had a perfect passing lane, had Madison General wide open with a good shooting angle, but the pass was right in by the body, just poor execution.
Pass into the middle for Churchill. Carries it behind the net. Hard shot after the pass. And the rebound picked up by Peterborough. A shot stopped again by Busby Korver. Just barely holding it.
That was very similar to the Riley Caldwell goal in that he went to the far side there. But this time Busby Korver just kind of left the foot back behind him just enough to get a hold of it.
Warriors on the offensive here. Good shutdown by the Lakers. Pass out, long shot from Lyle Hill. That one stopped easily by Hutchinson. And a penalty on the play. Boy, the Warrior coaching staff won't be too pleased with that. A slashing penalty 200 feet from their own net.
Plus, as we mentioned earlier, Wesley Whitlow with a couple of penalties at the far end of the floor. This time it's Spencer Martin, and he knew he'd done it because he immediately turned and ran to the penalty box. No argument, just went in and to serve his time. But that's not a good penalty to take when you're trailing 5-3 in what could be a championship game for the Lakers. Oh, just over halfway through the game, 7-12 to go here in the second.
Peterborough will take their time, working it around the outside. Ferguson tried to dump it off for Caldwell. 6 seconds on the shot clock, tough angle try. Bouncing off the crossbar and finding its way down the floor. Picked up by the Warriors, a breakaway chance, and a good save by Hutchinson to stop Colin Montour on a shorthanded breakaway.
And credit to Kitchen and Ferguson, who hustled back, didn't give Colin Montour the kind of room he would have liked to shoot. He had to kind of force a shot.
Try to get it back to Kitchen again. Shot from the far side from Churchill, though, was kept out. Churchill, Kitchen, Caldwell, Ferguson fakes the pass and sends it back to the other side. Ferguson again up top, has a look, brings it to the near side, takes it back, good movement now on the far side by the Lakers. Caldwell the near corner, here comes a shot, good save, and the rebound picked up by Caldwell. 40 seconds left in the power play. Backdoor try is not gonna work, and the Warriors will pick up possession and race it back down the floor. And again, a couple of Peterborough power play members need to hurry back into a defensive stance.
Great job by Armstrong that time, because Montour was running away from Ferguson, who was looking a little tired, and opening some space, and a nice angle by Armstrong to deny the lane to the net.
Ferguson just hustled over to the Peterborough bench after a long defensive shift as well. Now a nice pickoff for Peterborough, and this is a partial breakaway for Jake Venton. He is stopped and the ball just barely trickling over the net. And a nice attempt by the Peterborough defender looking for his fifth of the playoffs.
Yeah, the captain hustling out, doesn't score a ton, but like many a defensive captain, he seems to get key goals.
So 5 minutes left to go in the second, 5-3 Peterborough.
Chin strap undone, so it's a violation, equipment violation.
Long feed down the floor for Caldwell, winds and fires, and he just missed it by a couple inches. Almost too many men for the Warriors as Gavin Skye picked up the loose ball coming off the bench. We were tied at three after the first period. It's a 2-0 Peterborough period here. Backdoor attempt not going to work as Wes Whitlow's try bounces high and over the glass.
Whitlow wide open to the side of the crease, takes the pass from Isaiah Mount Pleasant, but he was on the wrong side of the floor, and he's a righty shooter, was on the righty side of the floor, or on the left side.
Armstrong driving the net, kept out. Ferguson now dishing it off for Adam Kitchen. There's a penalty coming up on the play.
There's two penalties
coming
up.
Yeah, I was going to say there might be more than one now.
There was one coming. The penalty, the refs had their hands up in the air, both of them. Colton Armstrong was down on the floor looking like he's in a lot of pain, and as he started to get up, Emmett Smith just cross-checked him again, so the slash is the first one and then the illegal cross-check, so he'll get 4 minutes. And boy, for a team that has worked so hard to try to get back into this game, it's going to be 7 minutes, so 2 for the first one, 5 for the second one, and they're really shooting themselves in the foot here.
Lakers with power plays 5 and 6 on the night. They've scored once and they've come close a couple times as well. Lots of time, no rush. They will still be on the power play when this period ends. Caldwell, near side, looking back door. Lakers can't get the shot. Kitchen has to race for a loose ball, does. Able to keep it in and scooped up by Ferguson. Played into the middle for Jacobs and he's knocked down. Caldwell scoops up the loose ball, but the shot clock will go.
And I'll tell you, if the refs hadn't just called 7 minutes against Six Nations, they might have called it for the can opener that Fox McKenzie just laid on Darian Jacobs, sticking the stick between his legs and just twisting him down to the ground.
3.5 to go in the second period, 5-3 Peterborough. Again, no shot clock when you're killing a penalty, so Tyler Fox McKenzie will just take some punishment at the Peterborough end. Down in the near side corner. Play gets blown dead.
Yeah, a little push in the back there from Colin Brown.
Nice play out of the corner by Bailey Skye for the Warriors. He got stopped by Hutchinson, but he's able to grab his own rebound, at least for a second. And he'll keep the possession.
Great effort by Skye. And he's going to go and take a break on the bench now.
Yeah, well deserved as he gets a replacement. Again, 5-on-4. Then you can see Six Nations getting frustrated. The physical play away from the ball really starting to pick up. 2:45 to go in the frame. This is Cecil Montour. He'll hold it along the near side boards. Three Lakers get in hard on him, and big Montour able to fight them off. May have fought off a high stick or two as well. And now the big guy over to the bench for some fresh penalty killing legs.
Montour is a big body and he was taking some punishment, and his face mask actually got knocked away. His chin strap came loose and I thought we were gonna have a call, and I was ready for the Warriors coaches to be furious because obviously it was loose because he was hitting the face with a stick.
So back underway. Just shy of 2 minutes to go. Lakers have their man pinned on the far boards. Ball comes loose, and the Lakers didn't disengage, so they blow the whistle. A quick pass in front, and robbed point blank was Spencer Martin. But the Warriors get the ball back again.
Riley Martinell picked it up and stepped in the crease just on the line, but that's enough for a back in call.
So far, so good for the Warriors on this penalty kill. There's a try across the front. And again, the Lakers push a man into the crease.
The Warriors get the ball back, and they've actually controlled play throughout this penalty. We thought they were shooting themselves in the foot with the 7 minutes, but maybe it was their strategy.
So again, they take their time to the Warriors. Isaiah Mount Pleasant's got a pretty good shot. We've seen it a couple times here tonight. He's not too worried about finding the net right now. He just wants to eat up as much time as he can with two Lakers. Riley Martinell being one of them, just pinning him to the boards. And finally, the Lakers will get back the ball.
Yeah, Mount Pleasant trapped the ball against his chest, they're saying, but he and Martinell are pushing and shoving, and then a left punch thrown by Mount Pleasant, and he's going to take a penalty for it.
Right in front of the referee, too, and that's what I don't understand. Is
one step away from him. Just not wise.
Not wise at all, and the Lakers now only up by a man for 4 minutes. Almost want to give them the ball. That one hit both posts, and Mount Pleasant thought he could maybe hide away on the bench. Not going to be the case. He'll take the long trot across the floor to give Peterborough power play number 7 tonight.
And it was tough. I mean, he was frustrated. He and Martinell get into it. He was fighting hard to keep the ball in the penalty kill and felt like he was being held, and he gets called for trapping the ball, but I think he did trap the ball. That's the thing. I think it was a good call. But, you know, the one thing, the Lakers penalty killers are coming in with their sticks very vertical and risking, or the man up guys in their own end, risking the high sticks, and they've been pretty lucky not to get a call yet.
Churchill bounce pass, Caldwell near side, back across, now out to Churchill. Caldwell fires, and a save made. Rebound picked up by the Warriors, played up ahead. Sky is chasing it down, gets to it, and stepped in the crease. That's all right, Hutchinson made the save at either way.
What a beautiful play by Bailey Sky, though. Two Lakers coming after him, and he manages to just pick up the ball super quickly and get it up and get a shot off. Unfortunately for him, stepped in the circle.
Hard shot stop, just 30 seconds left to go in the second period. Peterborough up 5-3. Six Nations with it off of the rebound, and they bring it back down here into the Peterborough end. And a penalty coming up to the Lakers. 10 seconds left in the period. Warriors might not even get a shot. They've got the ball in the far side corner. And now they'll blow the play dead and we'll get the call here at the end of the frame.
Well, it's going to be an illegal cross-check on Darian Jacobs. He knocked down Chauncey Hill, possibly from behind. Certainly the Warriors thought so, but it was marginal. He did knock him down. But the thing is, when it was a close call, he then goes over and cross-checks him while he's laying on the floor pretty viciously. So you're just asking for a penalty in that situation. Again, both teams showing a little lack of discipline here.
4.6 seconds left. And that's it. Not a whole lot of goals in the second period, but things certainly are starting to get a little spicy. Lots of penalties. And the Lakers with a 2-goal lead. After 40 minutes, I'd expect we're in for a whole lot of the same in the third period. Inside the Peterborough Memorial Center, the third period of Game 3 of the Meredith Cup Final is underway. Peterborough leading the Six Nations Warriors 5-3. David Foote, Stephen Stamp here on this simulcast presentation on Extra 90.5 FM and the JBI Sports Network. Warriors killing a penalty in just about a minute or so. All kinds of penalties at the end of the period. Playing, it is 4-on-3. All right, so Peterborough on the power play to start the frame.
Just for another 10 seconds, though, and then we'll go to 4-on-4. Then we'll have about a minute of a power play.
Long shot turned away by Busby Corver to the far side corner. Lakers able to get possession. This one backhanded out to the top for Riley Caldwell. Caldwell has Churchill on the near side, finds him there. Churchill trots toward the net. One hands off a pass to Ferguson, all the way across. Low bounce shot kept out by Busby Corver. Boy, how badly would the Lakers love to get the first goal of this third period and open up a 3-goal lead. Other end of the floor. And a shot wide by the Warriors. Comes back to the top of the zone. Pass to the near side, dump in attempt as Mount Pleasant tried to just drop it inside for a cutting teammate. Didn't work, Lakers get it back. Shot clock ticking as Peterborough feeling a bit of a press from the Warriors. Long feed ahead though for Adam Kitchen. He'll collect it in, settles it down, and then fires it back to the line for Churchill. Churchill to Ferguson, and then got knocked down hard. Back to his feet. 7 seconds on the shot clock. Churchill winding his way to the net. Just put it wide. A rebound try is stopped by Busby Korver. And a loose ball in the far side corner is scooped up by Six Nations' Riley Jamieson. Jamieson gave it to Owen Martin. He'll run the floor. Stops inside the Peterborough zone. And hands it off to Lyle Hill. Passes off to a cutting teammate. Shot missing. Rebound collected by the Warriors again. Madison General spins back in the corner. Hits Owen Martin. Brings it across, and the shot from Montour will be stopped.
And Six Nations hasn't even been playing as though they're trying to kill a penalty. They've just been going to the net, and they're going to get the ball back as we had a check after the ball had popped loose from Owen Martin. So now, though, another penalty coming. Or they just sent, no, they're just sending Emmett Smith back to the box for another second.
And now he's out. So back to 5-on-5 after quite a while. One more player will come off the Warrior bench. Peterborough Lakers, 17 minutes from hoisting the Meredith Cup if they can keep this lead intact. Warrior shot stopped, ball loose at the edge of the crease. Everybody digging for it. The Warriors get a chance and shoot, but in the crease. And that goal's gonna be waved off.
A good call, but what a tough break for Wesley Whitlow, who had the ball with his back to the net, one hand shot over the shoulder, finds the back of the net, but the Peterborough Lakers had done a good job shoving him into the crease before he let go of that ball. No question it's the right call, but boy, he is snake bit.
Near side pass intended for Churchill got deflected and carried up the floor with some speed by Gavin Scott. Able to corral it in the Peterborough end. Shot stopped by Hutchinson. And he's got that ball lodged in his gear. So the Lakers will take it back. We've played 3 minutes, 45 seconds of the third period, 5-3. Peterborough in front.
Every possession that goes by is good news for Peterborough as the clock keeps ticking down, because this Six Nations team is still working very hard to try and get back into it.
Trying to fight to the net is Darian Jacobs, all tied up at the top of the Six Nations crease and wasn't able to get a shot away. Now gives a shove on Dalton Van Every and will continue to chase Van Every around in the Warrior zone. Six Nations finally move it up the floor to Riley Jamieson. Scratch that, Spencer Martin fell, gets back to his feet and tries to bully his way to the net. Ran into a wall though and gave up possession.
Huge hit by Trent LaRocque. He just came out of nowhere to throw that body into Spencer Martin.
Brown for Montour, crossed the zone down low. Played back into the middle, and the Lakers have done a good job of shutting down that middle of the floor, not letting the Warriors get too many good shot opportunities. Lakers have the ball here. Up the floor, Adam Churchill again, wearing number 5 for Peterborough. Back to Adam Kitchen, fresh off the bench. Kitchen for Ferguson. Sends it to the far side. And no shot yet. As a stick up in the face of Armstrong. There was no call. Lakers did get a shot. It was stopped by Busby Korver. And he'll send it down the length of the floor. Offensive chance, though, breaks down quickly for Six Nations. Bradley Hill. Passes it near side. Another pass up top, low sub shot. And stop.
And you mentioned the offensive chance broke down for the Warriors. A great pass by Busby Korver up to Vern Hill. And Hill was turned back as Jake Benton sprinted off the bench at a perfect angle to take away the shooting angle for Vern Hill. Forced him to set things up slowly.
Only 9 seconds left on the Peterborough shot clock, and they'll lose the ball behind the Six Nations net. Warriors will have it back and they'll take their time coming up the floor. Now a quick pass, almost intercepted. Bouncing ball corralled by Emmett Smith. Smith trying to fight off the Laker defense, 10 on the shot clock. As he plays it off to Spencer Martin. Martin tries to get a shot away, and it missed. And there was no touch either, so the shot clock will expire, and Peterborough will get back the ball. 13 and a half to go as they protect the 5-3 lead.
Nice alert defense by the Lakers as the ball bounced out to Tyler Brown, and they managed to knock it away before he could corral it because he was wide open on the crease for a shot.
Nervous moments here for Peterborough as they chase their first Meredith Cup title. Ferguson dished it off. Good ball movement in tight. Ferguson with a good shot. The rebound wide of the net after a nice save by Busby Korver. Another try stop. Another try just over the net. Peterborough throwing everything they've got at the Six Nations net here about 7 minutes into the third period. Not able to score, and they'll give the ball up as well, and we'll see this Peterborough defense go back to work.
Yeah, the call is that the Lakers went through the crease and then played the ball, so they'll give it up to the Warriors. And I'll tell you, Six Nations worked hard to come back in game one, got within a goal, and then the Lakers reached into their bag, their maturity, to try and to pull away, and they did so. We'll see if they can do the same thing here, because they're certainly facing some pressure from the Warriors.
Good vocal crowd here again tonight at the PMC. And this game was only moved here due to the request of the fans. People said they were going to come out and support this team. They certainly have done that here tonight. Long pass from the goaltender. Hutchinson deflected. Riley Caldwell's able to pick it up. Gives it to Churchill. He'll carry it in, jogging and now stopping just along the near boards. Slung across to the far side. The return feed to the middle is intercepted by the Warriors and brought back up the floor. Spencer Martin.
Penalty coming to Peterborough.
Martin sending it back. Montour, no shot. I keep saying Spencer Martin. I expect the goaltender from the Steelheads to show up somewhere. The Mississauga Steelheads, of course, of the OHL, and now we get a penalty coming up here against the Lakers at a crucial point of this third period, protecting the two-goal lead, and they'll be down a man.
Too many men on the floor for the Lakers as they rushed the defense out there when the Warriors had a bit of a break. I always think of Spencer Martin, a guy I used to row with at the University of Victoria, so everyone has a different frame of reference, obviously.
We got a Spencer Martin. Somebody else had Josh Daly, the Warrior goaltender, down as John Daly.
It said it on the sheet. Did say John Daly, so we were thinking we were back in the heyday. Oh, what a shot.
Nice quick stick goal. That was almost a matter of time. A power play goal for the Six Nations Warriors. And it is now 5-4. And you had to wonder when they were going to get one that was set up well. And well, a man left open in the back door.
They've had so many chances. They've hit so many posts. You can see some frustration building. But that time, Isaiah Mount Pleasant, they're just moving the ball quickly around the, actually around the perimeter of the power play setup. But it went so quickly that Drew Hutchison just couldn't get across quickly enough. And Isaiah Mount Pleasant buried it. He's had some chances before. And as you mentioned, a good shooter. Just accuracy there more than, actually in quickness more than power, the real keys. Both goalies go to get a drink of water.
Yeah, well-deserved for both of those guys. They've seen lots of action. It's only a 5-4 score line, but not for any lack of shots. Both goaltenders have been very good.
They have both been very good, and they're probably both very pleased that it is here at the Memorial Center with the air conditioning and not down at the Kinsmen, where things can get a little bit more humid.
Yeah, maybe a little nicer to slide on this turf as well than the concrete, perhaps.
Although the concrete, you can actually slide, whereas the turf, you tend to stick a little.
Yeah, we had an interesting chat the other day about possibly switching from turf to wood floor here at the PMC.
Yeah, Teddy Higgins saying that when this floor is worn out in a number of years, he'd be interested in having a wooden floor installed, much like the New Westminster Salmon Bell is a gorgeous floor out on the West Coast, and the Burnaby Lakers have done the same thing.
So it is 5-4 now, Peterborough. We are approaching the midway point of this third period. If the Lakers win the game, they win the series. They win the Ontario Junior C Championship. Have to fight off the Warriors here, though, as they get a chance in front. Hutchinson made a couple of great stops.
What a nice play by Jake Venton with the push in the back to stay out of the crease as he runs around the line and gets behind the net. Veteran move by the captain. I'll tell you, the Lakers, one other reason they want to win tonight, they don't want to go back to Six Nations,
no.
Face a game four. And then if there's a game five right now, it's scheduled for the Ennismore Arena, where they really have no home floor advantage.
Yeah, Ennismore. There's a shot, they score! Bolton Armstrong has another. Picked up a rebound, and with the goaltender down and out, had a wide open cage, and he put it home with authority.
Bolton Armstrong making like Phil Esposito with the garbage goal just on top of the crease. He's battling a couple defenders, but very alert to see the ball roll out. The goaltender, Busby Korver, diving out after it. It just eluded him, so he was down on his hands and knees. All Armstrong had to do was turn around and flip it into the open cage.
Big goal for the Lakers at this juncture of the game. Now up 6-4 here in this third period. A little bit of insurance, and if I'm Coach Barker and staff, I'm telling the boys to just keep it going here. You don't want to let off the pedal at all, something that Peterborough teams have become a little known for almost in Major Series and Junior A, just having a bit of a lull and allowing the other team back in the game. Is a hard shot, that time from Kitchen, rattled off the right post.
I'll tell you one thing, this Junior C team, though, not really falling into that. In game one, the...
Hang on, we got a scrap here behind the plate.
Fox McKenzie and
Darian Jacobs for Peterborough, and it's Jacobs who still has his helmet on and just letting fly on Fox McKenzie. And you can hear what the PMC faithful think about that little scrap.
Jacobs landed about half a dozen big bombs on Fox McKenzie, who is not too impressed that Jacobs kept his helmet on, finally managed to rip it off. After the fight was over, the referees had interceded. They're both being escorted to the hallways to their dressing rooms.
Fox McKenzie may have lost the fight, but he wins best hair.
He's got great hair.
That's fantastic.
Yeah, the tight black curls, and then he's got the red mohawk stripe, the wide painted on mohawk stripe. It's some good looking hair.
So of course, night over for those two, as the wooden stick of Fox McKenzie gets passed down the tunnel.
And I was just saying that these Junior C Lakers have not fallen into that trap. Game one, they had the lead. The Warriors fought their way back, and the Lakers made a great reversal of the momentum and pulled away, got a few goals in the third period there, a couple in the second and one in the third to take in game two down in Six Nations when they had a lead. They just kept going. Coach Dave Baker said they could have had eight more goals if they'd been a little sharper with their shooting, so... They definitely have shown that they know what to do in this situation.
Yeah, they don't quite need eight more here, but they could use a couple as they're only up by a pair. 9 minutes left to go, 6-4 Lakers. Six Nations with the ball. A bounce shot will miss. And a big rebound is collected again by the Warriors. Played across, and that's going to be picked up. Breakaway chance, maybe. Lakers turn on the Jets. They shoot and score!
Are you kidding me? Trent LaRocque sprints down the floor, eludes his man, switches hands to his offside, and tucks it over the shoulder of the goaltender, Busby Korver. That is a sick display of stick skills. And actually, that was Dalton Hill. Gotta give credit. It looked like an eight. These uniforms are not the easiest to read, the eights, nine, and nines, because they have the big lift lock. It's a pretty cool looking jersey. We were talking about this before the game. They've got the wrap with the jersey that shows the lift locks. It looks cool, but you lose the bottom half of the number completely.
It's a nightmare for the broadcasters, but it looks good on the floor. And
all of which is to say that I screwed up. Said Trent LaRocque, Dalton Hill, switching hands from lefty to righty and tucks it home.
Yeah, fantastic. Sixth goal of the playoffs at 5 coming into the night. So 7-4 Peterborough. That is a very big goal. No team has scored more than 3 goals in a period yet tonight. Both had 3 in the first. Peterborough had 2 in the second. And now 2-1 Peterborough here in the third.
And Peterborough's given up only 14 goals in the whole series.
Which again just goes to show why guys like Wesley Whitlow have been so frustrated. It's not stemming just from the performance tonight. It's been all series long. The Laker defense has been suffocated. And now another chance down the floor for Peterborough. This time John Lynch in transition and thinks better of it. Knows they've got the lead, wants to protect it, and instead circles back to the bench and lets the offense go to work.
Well, it's such a smart play by Lynch because he was looking for the lane to the net. If it was there, you could see he was going to take it. There's a quick shot on the quick stick, but you know he turned aside because he didn't have a good shot. He could have got a shot off, and if they desperately needed a goal, maybe he pushes there, but he knew they're ahead.
No point risking an odd man rush the other way. Warriors with it here in the offensive zone now. 7:35 to go. Lakers up three. 10 seconds on the Six Nations shot clock. Brought to the near side. Shot to the near post. Wide of the net. And Peterborough have the rebound. Up ahead for Kitchen. Streaking off the bench all alone. Scores!
Bounce shot by Adam Kitchen. And the whole, almost the whole Lakers bench heads out to congratulate him. A great play by Kitchen, streaking down the floor and bouncing the shot past Busby Korver, but credit at the other end to Jake Venton. Such a neat little move when he got the ball at the edge of the crease, faked like he was going behind his net and came out front instead, just shook the Six Nations Warrior player, and that opened him up, and then he made the perfect angle, long angle pass up to Kitchen.
Now this is where things start to really get interesting. You gotta think the Warriors aren't gonna let up yet. They wanna try and tie this game, but if Peterborough gets one or two more, they may start to get a little defeated, and then who knows. Either way, Peterborough 7 minutes away from a provincial title.
You know, the Lakers started this program a number of years ago now. There's a big movement to try and get a junior C team that hadn't been around. And they were very successful off the get-go and then really ran into some struggles against some good Whippy teams, some good Clarington teams, and then Cornwall. But this year, they have really overcome a lot to get themselves in this position with just a ton of hard work.
Good group of returning guys who had a heartbreaking playoff exit last year against Cornwall and then got a chance to avenge that loss against Cornwall. Really had an outstanding playoffs to this point, sweeping Gloucester in two games, going six games with Cornwall, and then going four games only against, you mentioned, a very tough Clarington Shamrocks
team.
Best
of five, and the thing is, Peterborough played Clarington four times in the regular season, lost all four games.
Yeah.
So, you know, the Shamrocks went into that series as favorites, and a couple of one-goal wins by the Lakers showing a lot of maturity and character, and one really big, like seven-goal win.
Now, long story short, if the Lakers hold off for the next 5 minutes, 50 seconds, it will be a well-deserved title as that hard shot catches the glass and ends up here in the stands.
Spencer Martin going after Colton Armstrong. Now he's trying to rip away from the referee. He's going to go to the penalty box. He was after Armstrong. They were facing each other. And then Martin grabbed Armstrong by the face mask. The referee came and grabbed him. He still was chasing after Armstrong. There's a guy who might be one that you're just saying could escalate things a little bit on the physical side. Him and Gavin Skye, I think, has been getting. Oh, he's gone because he did fight. Oh, no, it was Fox McKenzie. So Gavin Skye, number 40, another guy who's played a very strong, tough game for them.
Hutchinson made another good save. Could possibly be the player of the game for the Lakers, one of them at least. Only four goals allowed, only one allowed since the first period. 5-12, long shot. That one hit the Six Nations goaltender, got out of play. Peterborough get a fresh 30 in the offensive zone.
I'm going to throw another name in for player of the game.
Sure.
Jake Venton, the captain, the steady defender, the leader of that defensive unit, who as a group have been fantastic. And now Gavin Skye, almost on cue, is going after Colton Armstrong. He's just taken one penalty.
Armstrong smartly just backing off. Why engage? You don't need to bother with it at this point.
No, you're up 8-4. You're going to go win a championship. And Skye is going after him, and now they're going to go. Nope. Armstrong's just like, no, I'm not going to go with you.
See, I don't understand why the refs haven't jumped in at this point. Armstrong clearly doesn't want to go.
Yep, he's being smart. The refs just let them keep going at him. Skye goes after him, rips off Armstrong's helmet, rips off his jersey. And surely they're not sending Colton Armstrong to the dressing room. He didn't throw a punch. All he did was walk
up.
Away.
You know what? It's eerily,
they're just sending him to the bench.
Eerily similar to game two of the Junior A series in this building a couple nights ago when Six Nations felt the game was out of hand, even though it was game two. It got very, very physical. And three or four fights breaking out in that game. And the Lakers, you know, for the Junior A's, it's better to not be a part of it because you don't want anybody suspended. Here, why bother being a part of it when there's 4:40 left to go?
Yeah, there's no point. I mean, you're about to celebrate a championship. Keep your uniform on, keep your helmet on, and be able to be on the floor immediately with your teammates rather than having to come back later. having had the first shower.
I'm sure either way they won't matter once that
that's true.
That trophy has been presented, but either way, you know, no point in engaging in any of the silliness here as we get late in the game. To reset for you, 4:41 to go, 8-4 the Lakers lead. They've exploded offensively here in the third period and really have just put the pedal down on the Six Nations Warriors.
It's funny that you say it's they've exploded offensively. They've scored three goals in the period, which by this series standards is an explosion.
Yeah.
You have to put it in context. Spencer Martin is going to the penalty box. You got to assume he's serving the penalties for Gavin Skye. And you got to respect Terry Hill's decision there, because Martin was a guy who was getting frustrated and was the most likely candidate other than Skye to continue that kind of behavior.
So there is a 9 minutes worth of penalties up on the Six Nations side, double the amount of time left in the game.
So unless we go to overtime.
Unless we go to overtime.
With four shorthanded goals.
Yeah, needless to say, a bad penalty to take for the Six Nations Warriors. Peterborough can just take their time, take a few possessions, take a few shots as they do on that one. Long pass down the floor, shorthanded breakaway though shaping up. And a great save by Hutchinson again. He has stopped three or four breakaways at minimum tonight.
Chauncey Hill with a great chance. I'll tell you, when I said, unless we go to overtime with the four shorthanded goals, one of the fans right in front of us said, bite your tongue, because she didn't want to see it happening. And seconds later, Chauncey Hill is breaking away. But yeah, Hutchinson, certainly a strong candidate for player of the game with another great save. And that pass hits the official.
So the Warriors take it into the offensive zone, down four. Busby Korver heads to the net. Here's a shot, missing wide, and a slashing penalty. Looks like it's going to go the way of the Peterborough Lakers.
It is the Lakers. I think it's Tom Weber heading off to the box. Yeah, it will be Weber. I tell you, he's another one of those gritty defenders for the Lakers. And occasionally you're going to go over the line. I don't think they're going to be too upset about this one because it was just, you know, just playing some hard defense in front of his own net.
.20 seconds on the shot clock, 3:20 on the game clock. Peterborough is that far away from hoisting the Meredith Cup. Nations working around the outside. Again, that Peterborough defense does a great job. Shot's going to be deflected. It'll miss the net. And the Warriors, with just 4 seconds left to get a shot, they do. Save made by Hutchinson. Lakers pick up the loose ball.
Penalty coming to the Warriors.
Churchill's just going to saunter into the offensive zone. Lakers not even pulling for the extra attacker on the delayed penalty at this point.
Shot clock's still running. They're actually down. They're shorthanded. I'm not sure why the shot clock's running, but they give up the ball anyway. The Warriors get possession, and the call will be made.
So 2:36 left to go as the celebration prolonged for
there. No more penalties. Just keep them out until you can get the ball back.
2.5 minutes to go. Adam Churchill with the ball, sends it down into the near corner, takes a return feed, has a look to the far side, thinks about a shot, and then dishes it off again. Kitchen, hard pass across. What a great feed back to Churchill. He scores. Brilliant ball movement from the Lakers. And if that's not the dagger in the coffin, I don't know what is.
2:14 to go, the power play goal. And Riley Caldwell was sitting so patiently with his stick raised over on the far side of the crease, waiting for a pass. And when it came, it didn't spend more than a fraction of a second in his stick. And he fired it across to Churchill, who buries it into the wide open net. Very unselfish play by Caldwell. He's been one of those quiet contributors for this team that has really helped them. to come within now 2 minutes and 12 seconds. We have another fight coming. This one right off the faceoff. Colin Montour squaring off with Dalton Hill.
These two waste no time getting the buckets off. There's some good right hands from Dalton Hill connecting with an uppercut, then got jerseyed, and those two will keep going back and forth. We got another fight down the other side of the floor as well, as this one just turning into a bit of a gong show, trading punches down the other end.
Oh.
Our Cecil Montour, and I couldn't get
Nick
the number.
Nick Salter for the Lakers, and he was absolutely filled in, and then they give each other a fist bump. It was actually Dalton Van Every, so a pair of Daltons. It's Dalton Van Every for Six Nations. They're going to the one end, and then Montour goes out. He and Salter go after it. They were just throwing bombs. Nobody's throwing up any defense on that one. No defense being played at all by those two. And Salter went down. Looked like he'd actually been knocked out because that one big hit by Montour floored him immediately. But Salter hopped up and ran off with a smile on his face. That's a tough kid.
I can't say we didn't predict it.
Yeah.
We knew that if the Lakers got up by a few once it got out of reach, this would likely happen. And I guess there's a couple guys who don't mind having to come back on the floor to celebrate.
There you go.
Because they were pretty willing participants in those two scraps.
Well, the first one right off the faceoff, they were ready to go. You could see Dalton Hill and Dalton Van Every had just had enough of whatever was going on out there between them. And it's going to take a bit to clear everything out. But Cecil Montour is over there enjoying himself, having a being very animated over on the Six Nations bench. Mime throwing a punch. Not sure if he's saying he's going to go out and do it or if he was just reenacting what had just happened.
Well, at least they're in high spirits, I guess.
You know, you've got to give some credit. Yeah, there's a big smile from Colin Montour as he goes over and points to Cecil Montour. Not sure if they're related. There are a lot of Montours on the Six Nations Reserve. It's like being in Evans here.
Right.
In Peterborough. There's just plenty of them. And, you know, a lot of them are related. Some not so much. But, you know, they are a young team, a smaller team. They're the third team in Six Nations because they have a Junior A and a Junior B team.
Right.
The Junior A team is in the OLA Finals against Peterborough. Both these centers doing very well. The Junior B team is battling to win yet another Founders Cup. There's a lot of depth on the Six Nations Reserve. It's an amazing program with skill up and down the roster. These guys have a lot of young players who want to move up through the ranks, but they're a good young team who look like they're going to be competitive for years to come.
So the Warriors have it. We'll get back to lacrosse here as we hit the 2 minute warning. Six Nations keeping it around the perimeter here. Low shot will miss. Big rebound. And you know the fans want more goals as Peterborough pick it up with just a minute 50 to go.
I'm about 90% sure they have one more goal. It says 8-4 on the board, but that last goal by Churchill with the pass from Caldwell, I'm pretty sure never went up on the scoreboard. So maybe the score clock operator just trying not to get things get out of hand. But Caldwell is tackled to the floor by Vern Hill. Just grabs a hold of his helmet and hogties him.
Minute 32 on the clock. Lakers are going to take it back into their own zone. They just want to kill the clock at this point. A year's worth of work. Comes down to three games in the Meredith Cup final. And Peterborough were outstanding again. Not just all series long, not just all playoffs long, but all season long, finishing 11-4-1 in the regular season.
And, you know, it's more than a year's work.
Even. Absolutely.
They've been building towards this with some great fourth and fifth year players. And this program has been growing, and it's well-deserved. And the celebration is starting in earnest in the final minute of this game.
45 seconds left. Lakers with the ball. They'll just hold on to it in their own zone. 34 seconds left, 10 on the shot clock. And imagine they're just going to launch it down the floor.
Yeah, the Six Nations players not taking any hacks or anything, not doing anything outrageous, just standing there and watching. So the Lakers, by the same token, just lob it into the corner and don't take a shot or anything. 15 seconds to go. Six Nations has the ball. They're going to throw it down the floor. And the Lakers are already celebrating. They're in a little bundle. shot by Six Nations. It's going to roll back down the floor, and that'll do it. Almost another fight as Tyler Brown is having words with Tom Weber, who, of course, just points.
The buzzer goes. The Peterborough Lakers are the 2015 Meredith Cup Ontario Junior C Lacrosse Champions as they flood onto the floor and to the far side corner to celebrate. For the first time in this city's history, for the first time in organizational history, the Lakers are provincial champions, and who knows, could set the scene for the potential, what they're calling in this town, the Laker Triple Crown this season, with the Junior A's in the final and the MSL Lakers certainly on a march towards a Man Cup anyway.
Yeah, the senior Lakers, of course, in the first round against Oakville, highly favored. They won't be favored against the Six Nations Chiefs if they play them in the final as expected, but they certainly have a chance at that one. The junior Lakers with a big win in game two, 14-4 over the Arrows. They're certainly moving towards it. But the Junior C Lakers, very much a part of the Lakers family, more and more so as the team has grown and matured, and they start things off with a bang.
The Lakers will finish up their celebrations. These teams will shake hands, and well, that'll put an end on another Ontario Lacrosse Association Junior C season. Any final thoughts?
Just, again, credit to the young Six Nations team. They battled hard, they never gave up, they kept going. But this is just a Peterborough Lakers team that you cannot say by any stretch of imagination they didn't earn it, as you mentioned, easy win over Gloucester in the first round, but then they beat the defending champs in Cornwall. They beat the undefeated regular season team from Clarington in the semis, and then in the finals they come out and in every game just show superiority. And it's so hard to tell between, because there's no overlap between the conferences. There's no interlocking play. You don't know until they get here, but the Lakers clearly the better team and deserving champions.
After going 11-4-1 in the regular season, the Lakers need just three games. They sweep the Six Nations Warriors to win the Meredith Cup. For Stephen Stamp, I'm David Foote, saying thank you so much for listening and watching on Extra 90.5 FM and the JBI Video Network, jbisportsnetwork.com, if you want to watch the game. So long for now, and we'll talk to you next time on the Hometown Sports Game of the Week on Talk Sports Radio.
Thank you.